गुड मॉर्निंग फ्रेंड्स, टुडे वी आर डीलिंग द क्लॉक ऑफ चैलेंजेस इन द मैनेजमेंट ऑफ द हार्ट फेलियर. व्हाट इज न्यू इन 2021 इन द हार्ट फेलियर विथ रिड्यूस इजेक्शन फ्रैक्शन. वी विल डिस्कस इट. आई वॉन्ट टेक मच टाइम, but the topic is very much interesting, and nowadays it is very very useful in day to day practice of the cardiologists and the physicians. So let us come on the dais. In heart failure, first we are starting from the epidemiology of heart failure. Heart failure is frequent. 64 million having 64 million patients worldwide. Out of that, 1 to 2% of the global population. 64 million means 1 to 2% of the global population, and up to 30% of global population will have heart failure by 2025. The heart failure is progressive. 9 of the 10 patients have symptoms despite treatment. Heart failure is deadly. Mortality by heart failure exceeds most cancers. 5 years mortality of heart failure exceeds that of prostate cancer. Heart failure is costly. 10% of all heart failure patients die during the first hospitalization, while remaining survivors die after second hospitalization within less than 18 months. But remember, it can be prevented and treated. Now, what is the definition of the heart failure? First, we are taking two definitions. First definition we are taking according to signs and symptoms of the heart failure. The clinical definition: heart failure is a clinical syndrome with typical symptoms and signs resulting from abnormality of cardiac structure or functions. Typical symptoms are breathlessness, ankle swelling, and fatigue. Typical signs: fluid retention, such as pulmonary condition, elevated jugular vein pressure, and pulmonary tachycardias and pulmonary edema resulting in a reduced cardiac output and or elevated intracardiac pressure at rest or during stress. Many of the signs of heart failure may resolve quickly with diuretic therapy. The second definition of the heart failure according to ejection fraction by European Society of Cardiology 2016 heart failure guidelines. Types of heart failure by left ventricular ejection fraction criteria. The first will be reduced ejection fraction heart failure. Second, mid-range ejection fraction heart failure. And lastly, third one, reserved ejection fraction heart failure. So heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, symptoms and signs will be same which we have discussed in slide number 2, means the last slide. And here ejection fraction will be less than 40%. And second, heart failure mid-range, here again symptoms and signs will be same which we have discussed in the second slide last time, and ejection fraction will be 40 to 49%. But you must know that here elevated levels of the nitrogen peptides will be there, and at least one criteria, a relevant structural heart diseases and or left atrial enlargement will be there, and there will be diastolic dysfunction. Now, in preserved ejection fraction, symptoms and signs are the same as we have seen the slide number 2. And ejection fraction is here more than 50%, while in mid-range it was 42-49%, and in reduced it was less than 40. And then there will be in preserved there will be elevated level of natriuretic peptides, and at least one criteria, relevant structural heart diseases and or left atrial enlargement will be there, and there will be diastolic dysfunction of the heart. You must remember and know, non-acute setting of the heart failure, BNP, broad natriuretic peptide will be more than 35, and in anti-pro-BNP and anti-pro-BNP will be more than 125 picogram per ml, which is positive for preserved ejection fraction heart failure. In acute setting, that was non-acute setting, but in acute setting, BNP will be more than 100, and anti-pro-BNP will be more than 300 picogram per ml, which is positive for preserved ejection fraction heart failure. You must note, in general, BNP level above 500 picogram per ml considered heart failure. BNP between 100 to 500 picogram per ml has a gray area where it is considered inconclusive. So, now we will compare American College of Cardiology Foundation and American Heart Association stages of heart failure classification and New York Heart Association functional classification. Here we will take American College of Cardiology Foundation and American Heart Association stages of heart failure. We have divided into 4 stages, A, B, C and D. A means a high risk of heart failure but without structural heart diseases or symptoms of the heart failure. B, structural heart diseases but without sign or symptoms of heart failure but there is LV dysfunction. C, structural heart disease with prior or current symptoms of heart failure and there is LV dysfunction. Then D, refractory and intractable heart failure requiring specialized intervention. Now, here we are supposed to know that what is refractory and what is intractable. Refractory heart failure presents despite intensive therapy. Intractable heart failure means resistant to all regular therapeutic measures. Now we come to New York Heart Association functional classification. It has got again 4 stages. Number 1, no limitation of physical activity. Ordinary physical activity does not cause symptoms of heart failure. Second stage, ordinary physical activity results in symptoms of heart failure. Stage 3, less than ordinary activity causes symptoms of heart failure. Stage 4. Symptoms of heart failure exist at rest. Means what? Unable to carry on any physical activity without symptoms of heart failure. Or symptoms of heart failure at rest. Now we are going to heart failure in Asia. Here we have taken the three categories. Asian heart failure, USA heart failure, and European Society Cardiology heart failure. So, first we'll take the Asian. Before that, I would like to discuss causes of heart failure. Number one, rheumatic heart disease responsible for more than half of the all admissions. Coronary heart disease is 55%. Valvular heart disease is 13%. Idiopathic dilated cardiomyopathy 10%. Hypertensive heart disease 6%. Unknown etiology 12%. And lastly, a previous MI seen in 22%. Now take Asian heart failure. Here we divide it into reduced ejection fraction and preserved ejection fraction. Now what is the age in ERs? In reduced, it is 60 plus minus 13. In preserved, it is 68 plus minus 12. Now BMI in kg per meter square, it is in reduced it is 25 plus minus 5, and in preserved it is 27 plus minus 6. Then the CAD percentage, it is 50% in reduced and it is 29% in preserved. Now hypertension percentage, it is 52% in reserve, in reduced, and 71% in preserved. Then diabetes percentage, this is 40% in reduced and this is 45% in preserved ejection fraction. What is the goal of therapy in heart failure? Number one, increase survival. Second, reduce hospital admissions. Third, make people feel better. What do you mean by increased survival? Reduce mortality, premature death, ideally by reducing two main modes. Number one, sudden cardiac death or death from progressive heart failure, that is pump failure. Second, reduce hospital admissions. Apart from being very unpleasant for patients, distressing for families, and costly, it is a bad prognostic development. It is also true of any episode of worsening heart failure, requiring intensification of the therapy. Then make people feel better. What do you mean by this? Number one, improve symptoms and quality of life, or at least slow rate of deterioration. Second, allow people to continue to lead as normal and unrestricted lifestyle as possible as much. Now we are going to discuss pharmacological therapy. The choices we have what? Number one, ACE inhibitor and ARB. Here, ARBs are valsartan. And you know the anisipril, what are those? This is the charms. And by the Copernicus second drug is the beta blocker. Then third is by release mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist, that is spironolactone and eplerenone. Now these are the three main pillars, and also we can take niprilysin inhibitor by Paradigm heart failure. This is known as sacubitril, the brand name. Niprilysin inhibition by sacubitril. Then second, SGLT2 inhibitor, that is dapagliflozin. Then third, we will take varicigot by Victoza. It is used in worsening heart failure. Then lastly, we take the drug ivabradine by Ceftori. It is used in sinus rhythm when heart rate is more than 70 beats per minute. Remember, sinus rhythm, never atrial fibrillation, never atrial fibrillation. Now, principles and the pathophysiologic targets of reduced ejection fraction pharmacotherapy. We have got the five pathways: angiotensin second, norepinephrine, aldosterone, naprilysin, and SGLT. Now, there are four drugs. ARNI. ARNI means what? Means ACE inhibitor and ARB. Or if and so if you take this ARB like valsartan, you must have add niprilysin inhibitor. This constitute ARNI. Valsartan, that is ARB plus niprilysin inhibitor, it constitutes ARNI. Second beta blocker, bisoprolol or metoprolol or carvedilol. Third, MRAS, mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist, that is spironolactone and eplerenone. Lastly, SGLT2 inhibitor, that is dapagliflozin. Then three others we can use, three additional pathways shown to improve outcome in specific populations. Number one, ivabradine. In normal sinus rhythm, heart rate more than 70 beats per minute. Second, hydralazine combined with nitrates, isosorbidinitrate. It is used in self-identified blacks. Then lastly, varicigot in worsening heart failure. So you can now use these four drugs: mineral receptor antagonist, beta blockers, ARNI, and SGLT2 inhibitor, dapagliflozin. But remember, these are the drug interventional for reduced ejection fraction, the main. But if there is anticoagulant, if there is patient is in atrial fibrillation, you must use anticoagulant. And you must use digitalis if high ventricular rate. And also refer to surgeon for pulmonary vein isolation. And if you see there is left bundle branch block or white QRS, means QRS complex more than 120 milliseconds and ejection fraction is less than 30%, use CRTP and CRTD. CRTP means this is biventricular pacing, and CRTD means biventricular pacing with defibrillator. Then, if you see the sinus rhythm and heart rate more than 70 beats per minute, use Evabradine, channel pacemaker current IF. Use Evabradine, channel pacemaker current IF inhibitor in newer heart association class second to four with ejection fraction less than 30%. Useful in chronic worsening heart failure in combination therapy or when beta blocker contraindicated or not tolerated. The dose will be 2.5 to 7.5 mg BD orally. Now, if you see the pulmonary congestion or congestion in the whole body systemically, then loop diuretics adhere like thiazides, especially chlorthalidone, 50 to 100 mg per day orally. And if you see if there is recent decompensation or advanced heart failure, that is stage D heart failure, then you must use varicigot in worsening heart failure. The doses are 2.5 to 10 mg orally. Also, you can use Omecamtiv, a cardiac myosin activator which helps in reducing ejection fraction. Maximum dose is an infusion of 0.5 mg per kg per hour. Also, in decompensated heart failure, you must use digitalis. Use when BP is low and to control the heart rate. Or, if patient is serious, you can refer to left ventricular assist devices or for heart transplantation. Then, if you see that mitral edge to edge repair is required, if disproportionate functional mitral regurgitation is seen, refer for mitral edge to edge repair to cardiac surgeon. And if you see a person self-identified back, use hydralazine with isosorbide dinitrate. And if you see that with hernia it is costly to the patient, then use only ACE inhibitor and ARB, but not the naproxen inhibitor. And if you see the ferritin level in the blood is less than 100 and T-stat is less than 20%, use ferric carboxymaltose. You must know what is T-stat. Transferrin saturation is the serum iron divided by the total iron binding capacity, TIBC, which corresponds to circulation iron, circulating iron. Normal values are 250 to 450 microgram per deciliter. A higher level means that you may have iron deficiency anemia, and normal values are 15 to 50%. Now we are going again. We are continuing the pharmacotherapy. The five pillars of reduced ejection fraction therapy 2020. We have got five pillars and four pills. Now you must know the first pillar is ARB, angiotensin receptor blocker, valsartan. Second pillar is naproxen inhibitor, and if we combine both, it becomes SIDMUS. Third pillar is beta blocker. Fourth pillar is mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist. And the last one, the fifth pillar is SGLT2 inhibitor dapagliflozin. So there are five pillars, but four pills. It will be one pill. second pill, third pill, fourth pill. Now, ACE inhibitor and ARB, valsartan, plus naproxen inhibitor becomes Sigmus, that is one pill. Beta blocker, bisoprolol or metoprolol or carbidolol, second pill. Then mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist, for example, spironolactone and eplerenone, third pill. Then SGLT2 inhibitor, dapagliflozin, the fourth pill. Now suggested approach from a heart failure specialist. Try to start all four medications which modulate five different neurohormonal pathways within 4 to 6 weeks. Forget not, carefully monitor safety and tolerability. Second, the greatest benefit for patients occurs at the lowest initial dose. The maximum dosage studies in RCTs provide incremental benefit. Third, try to cover the five different pathways with lower doses initially of the four different medications. Then 2013 update to the 2017 American College of Cardiology and your ACDP means expert consensus decision pathway. According to American College of Cardiology, an expert consensus decision pathway for optimization of heart failure with reduced ejection fraction treatment. Major changes in expert consensus decision pathway includes two medical therapies elevated to front line. First is angiotensin receptor blocker combined with naproxen inhibitor are now the preferred first line renin angiotensin inhibitor. Second, sodium glucose co-transported to SGLT2 inhibitors are now a part of the foundation of medical management. Now we are continuing pharmacotherapy, initiating guideline-directed medical therapy for reduced ejection fraction heart failure 2021. Established therapies are ARNI, ACE inhibitor, ARBs, beta blocker, loop diuretics, mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist, and hydralazine with isosorbide dinitrate. Accepting loop diuretics, they all improve symptoms, reduce hospitalization, and prolong survival. Then ARNI and SGLT2 are the preferred, but for patients in whom ARNI administration is not possible due to fall of BP or angioedema or higher cost of medicine, then an ACE inhibitor combined with ARB is recommended. Use of desoxin as a treatment for reduced ejection fraction lacks new data. Current role as a rate control agent for atrial fibrillation in those with low BP is suggested. Initiation of a beta blocker is better tolerated when patients are dry. Dry means they don't have pulmonary congestion. And an ACE inhibitor or ARB with ARNI is suggested when patients are wet, means there is no pulmonary congestion. Only evidence-based beta blockers should be used. Now, in pharmacotherapy, we have gone to, or we have come to, reduced ejection fraction stage C treatment. Here, ARNI S inhibitor, ARB, and remember Anish Bifat, and evidence-based beta blocker with diuretic agents are needed. First, we will go to for patients with estimated GFR in kidney more than 30 ml per minute or creatinine less than 2.5 mg per deciliter in male and less than 2 mg per deciliter in female or potassium less than 5 milliequivalent per liter means and 2 in New York Heart Association class second to 4 if it present add mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist and this is the and then for patient meeting estimated GFR criteria and New York Heart Association class second to four. Here also second to four, here also second to four. You can add SGLT2 inhibitor. And for patient with persistent volume overload and New York Heart Association class second to four, you should titrate diuretics. And four, but here you see, in first and second there was heart failure classic class second to four, but here also again for patient with persistent volume overload and same for the same New York Heart Association class second to four titrate diuretics. And fourthly, for persistently symptomatic back patient despite any beta blocker, MRA or SGLT2 inhibitor and New York Heart Association class third to fourth, not second to fourth. Here it is third to fourth. Add hydralazine with isosorbide dinitrate. And fifth, for patient with resting heart rate more than 70 on maximally tolerated beta blocker dosage in sinus rhythm and if patient is in New York Heart Association class second to third, previously it was third to fourth, here second to third, then add Ivapredine. Now the JAMA network question is effect of dapagliflozin in patient with heart failure and reduced ejection fraction consistent in patient with and without type 2 diabetes mellitus. What is conclusion? In this exploratory analysis of a randomized clinical trial, dapagliflozin was effective at reducing cardiovascular morbidity and mortality in patients with heart failure and reduces ejection fraction independent of diabetes status. Now, prevention of the heart failure with SGLT2 inhibitor. Now we are taking single drug. What are the uses of SGLT2 inhibitor? That is very, very important because this is the latest drug. It reduces intrarenal oxidative stress and it reduces intrarenal angiotensinogen upregulation. Angiotensinogen constricts the blood vessel, but it decreases. Then SGLT2 inhibitor decreases interstitial fluid and intravascular volume also. SGLT2 increases natriuresis, osmotic diuresis, leading to decreased cardiac load. SGLT2 inhibitors increase glucagon, which may have positive inotropic and chronotropic effects. Then SGLT2 inhibitors increase ketone body formation, leading to improved myocardial energetics. You must know that ketone bodies in our body is an energy source during starvation. Then SGLT2 inhibitors improved metabolic parameters, like it decreases A1C, decreases body weight. Then SGLT2 inhibitors decreases BP without increasing heart rate, decreases arterial stiffness. Then lastly, but not the least, SGLT2 inhibitors decrease LV hypertrophic and cardiac remodeling fibrosis. So, possible mechanism leading to improvement in heart failure outcomes with sodium glucose transported to inhibitors. Now, we have come to, does empagliflozin improve outcome in patient with heart failure? Conclusion: among patients receiving recombinant therapy for heart failure, those in the empagliflozin group had a lower risk of cardiovascular death or hospitalization for heart failure than those in the placebo group, regardless of the presence or absence of the diabetes. Empagliflozin treated patients had a lower risk of serious renal outcome. Now, we have come to dapagliflozin in heart failure. Effect of dapagliflozin in heart failure with or without diabetes. An inflection point in the care of patients with heart failure. Number one, benefit seen in those with or without diabetes. Once a day therapy, that is single dose and no need for titration. But remember, you have to use low dose of starting. No episodes of hypoglycemia or diabetic ketosis is seen. Negligible incidence of amputations are there. The NNT number needed to treat are 21. Benefit seen even in those more than 75 years of age. The number needed to treat NNT is the number of patients you need to treat to prevent one additional bad outcome, means death or stroke. For example, if a drug has an NNT of 21, it means you have to treat 21 people with the drug to prevent one additional bad outcome. Then tips and tricks on how to use SGLT2 inhibitors in patients treated with diuretics. Use SGLT2 inhibitors only when euvolumic. So first consider what is the volume status, whether there is hypervolemia or whether there is hypovolemia or patient is euvolemic. Hypervolemia means if present, hypervolemia means rapid weight gain, edema, swelling, headache, shortness of breath, high blood pressure, congestive heart failure. Continue diuretic and BP, electrolytes and creatinine and body weight, assuming not hypertensive. Then caution with multiple diuretics. And if you see hypovolemia, means dehydration, low blood pressure, dizziness, panting, fatigue, thirst, weakness, nausea or vomiting, fast heart rate and decreased urine production, mental confusion, pallor or sleepiness, it means there is hypovolemia. So stop diuretic and monitor the diuretics and initiate SGLT2 inhibitor when euvolemic. And when patient comes in the euvolemia, what is the blood pressure? Whether he is hypertensive or hypotensive or not hypertensive. If he is hypertensive, then continue diuretic therapy and monitor BP, electrolytes, creatinine and body weight. Here I have seen the four steps which we are showing here. In first step, check volume status and blood pressure. Second step, consider if diuretic dose reduction is needed or if hypovolemia or hypertension is there. In third step, initiate SGLT2 inhibitor. In fourth step, keep daily weight monitoring. So, if the blood pressure is high, then continue diuretic therapy and monitor BP, electrolytes, creatinine and body weight. And if he is having hypotension, caution is required, hold or reduce diuretics and reinstitute if required. And when he is normotensive, then start loop diuretics, continue therapy and monitor. And in loop diuretic, you have to use thiazide. Consider reducing dose by 50% and monitor BP and body weight. If BP is stable, continue therapy. If BP increasing, reinstitute diuretics. If BP decreasing, stop diuretic. Here I am showing you the human face of the heart failure. There are so many things which you will find in this face. Atrial fibrillation, diabetes, anemia, iron deficiency, coronary diseases, angina, hypertension, asthma, COPD, prostatic disease, psychiatric illness, hyperkalemia, arthritis, glaucoma, cachexia, hyperuricemia, gout, renal impairment, sleep apnea, Parkinson's disease and cognitive impairment. Now we have come to the conclusion. What to take home message? Consider SGLT2 inhibitor as cardioprotective drug that in addition have glucose lowering effect rather than being a diabetes drug. And second, what to take home message, that current medications are what? Metformin 1 gram once daily, sacubitril and valsartan, that is Sidmus, should be used with the dosage 97 and 103 milligram. And bisoprolol should be used 10 mg once daily. Spironolactone should be used 25 mg once daily. Atorvastatin should be used 80 mg once daily. Aspirin should be used 81 mg once daily. Furosemide should be used 40 mg twice daily. Now, what to take home message? This is the last. So, discussions and implications of pathway 2021 are mainly 4 points. Number one, management of heart reduced ejection fraction often involves multidisciplinary care. Guideline directed medical treatment would be expected to significantly benefit affected patients. No guideline or pathway or algorithm should ever supersede clinical judgment, because the clinical practice guidelines continue to evolve. Fourth, cardiovascular diseases are the leading cause of mortality and morbidity in developed as well as developing countries. Heart failure is becoming an important contributor to death and disability in developed countries because of increasing vascular diseases as well as the persistence of pre-transitional diseases like rheumatic heart diseases and infectious cardiomyopathies. Now this burden is likely to be large. Why? Because India is home to 16% of global population. Second, India is 25% of the world's coronary heart disease burden. Third, India is having 120 million hypertensive patients. And fourthly, India is a large number of individuals with rheumatic heart diseases. So, my dear friends, we have finished the clock of challenges in heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, how to manage it in 2021. I am 100% sure that you have liked it and enjoyed the topic. And I thank you for your kind attention. And soon we are taking antihypertensive therapy within a week. I thank you for your kind attention.